Hi there, my name is Tudor Mitev, and in this short lecture titled Making the Unreal Seem Real, Speculative Realities and Design Fiction, I will briefly explore the concept and the practice of design fiction. And to begin, it's important to consider as a starting point the notion of the real itself. And reality is ever-changing, the world as such, the world we inhabit, the environment we operate in is ever-changing and it is complicated. It does not fit any one model perfectly. In fact, one could easily make an argument, which would be pretty much axiomatic, any and all models we use of the real, any and all models as such are imprecise. They are highly imperfect and they describe correctly only a very limited part of the real, a sliver of the real, and only for a limited amount of time. Because, again, the world is ever-changing and complicated. So, the models that we use and deploy to operate within a real are always, it can be simple or complex, but they're always imperfect and they always need revising. So, this is the starting point, the really important observation here. And it's framed quite simply and elegantly by military theorist John Boyd when he points out that to discern what is going on, we must interact in a variety of ways with our environment, right? So this is on the surface quite a trivial observation, but it has a really important insight hidden in it, which is that that interaction has to be continuous and it has to involve a variety of different ways, a variety of different approaches. This is, in other words, a continuous probing of our environment in order to figure out what is happening, in order to figure out changes to the environment, right? Because again, the real is ever-changing, it's complicated, and it does not fit any of our models, right? All our models are simplistic, crude approximations of the real. Even the most advanced scientific models are exactly that. So, John Boyd expands on this when he says that it's really important to examine that world we inhabit from a number of perspectives so that we can generate mental images or impressions that correspond to that world. Right, so the key thing here is that these images and impressions that we form are always already time and space bound in the sense that they correspond to a specific instance of the reality which we inhabit for a limited number of time because, again, reality is ever changing. So the key insight here is that our successful operating in an environment, in a world, in a reality requires us to continuously probe in a variety of ways, right? So not according to a single model, but in a variety of different ways that real in order to discern and examine it. And this is important because if we were to operate within the world, within an environment, according to a strict pre-existing model, right, according to a strict pre-existing formula, which might have worked in the past or might even still work, right? Over time, this invariably, right, so this is again an axiomatic observation, invariably over time, this leads to inertia, right, so where we're stuck operating in that way, which leads automatically to a crisis because we need to change and yet we cannot because we're stuck operating in this model and then eventually collapse of the system. Whatever that system might be, it might be an individual, it might be an organization or it might be a civilization for that matter, right? So invariably this leads to inertia, crisis and collapse. Why? Because that system, whatever it might be, failed to adapt to the external changing conditions. Right, it operated while keeping blindly to a model, to a pre-existing formula. Hence the importance of continuous probing and variance in the way we engage with the real. And here lies the problem, because Even though on the surface these are very trivial observations, one could say, yes, obviously this is important, and yes, obviously there is value in looking at the world and in probing the world in different ways. These are trivial observations. However, this is actually really hard to do. And it's really hard to do because we are construed to operate in the world according to pre-existing models. Our social structures, our organizational models, our civilizations, for that matter, operate in the real according to pre-existing models. And the longer these models have been in operation, the harder it is to change them, right? Because of this phenomenon of inertia, which again invariably leads to a crisis and eventual collapse. And Marshall McLuhan framed this condition really, really elegantly, as was his way when in his legendary book, The Medium is the Message, he described our condition as we looked at the present through a rear view mirror. We march backwards into the future. Right? Why backwards? With our backs towards the future? Because while we are trying to march into the future, our entire set of coordinates is shaped by the past. Right? Hence the rear view mirror. We look at the present and march into the future by behaving as if we are still in the past. Right? Our entire set of coordinates for thinking about reality and operating within reality is supplied by our past experiences. Right? To simplify this even further. So we have these sets of models of how we should do things and sets of practices that past performance has somehow established is appropriate for given conditions. But again, reality is ever-changing and complicated. So this invariably leads to problems. And as we established a little bit earlier, these problems can be described as inertia, crisis, collapse. And so it appears that the challenge is to look at our models in a way which allows us to somehow modify them fast enough so that we can avoid inertia, crisis and collapse, so that we can avoid falling into this trap of marching backwards into the future and looking at the present through a rearview mirror. And there is a sense here of the inevitability of change. And then the value and the importance of looking at things in a different way, right? In a way which is outside of the parameters of the frame of the model we are using. And this moment, right, in our thinking about reality and change is captured brilliantly by philosopher Franklin Spinney when he says, when things go out of whack, we can see something new and strange. And that is when we learn something, right? What does things going out of whack mean, right? It means things stop behaving the way we expect them to behave according to existing models, right? So we carry a model of reality in our heads. Organizationally, when we think of complex organizations, be they corporations, tribes, nation states, or civilizations for that matter, we always operate according to a model, right? Marching into the future while looking at the past, right? Looking at the present through a rearview mirror. But when things go out of their modeled behavior, when they go out of whack, that is when we learn something, because we discover the real again. Because remember, when we operate within a model, we pretty much do not have any interactions with the real. We have interactions with the model of the real. This is a really important distinction. So this is a key moment which I wanted to establish before we jump into the problem and exciting practice of design fiction. Because if there is a value in things going out of whack, perhaps there is a way where we could do this as a regular practice and in the process learn something new and avoid inertia, etc., etc., right? So the question becomes then, what if we made things go out of whack on purpose in a controlled manner, if you will, by creating speculative realities, by creating speculative versions of the real, which are not according to the existing model, which are different, right? Instead of discovering them by accident because something broke, what if we actually tried to create them on purpose? In a controlled manner. What would happen then? And here comes design fiction. Because this is exactly what design fiction as a concept, as a practice, was developed to achieve. And the term design fiction was coined by science fiction writer and design theorist Bruce Sterling, who's one of the founders of cyberpunk, among many other things he was involved in. So the way he described design fiction in 2012, if I'm not wrong, is the deliberate use of diegetic prototypes to suspend disbelief about change. Design fiction tells worlds rather than stories. So what does this mean? What does diegetic prototypes mean in the first place? And diegesis, the notion of diegesis comes from Greek, and it stands for the inside of a world, right? So the creation of a world. And initially in ancient Greece, it was used to describe the kind of world building that storytellers engaged in, right? So when you're describing in detail the world in which a protagonist operates, this is diegesis, right? You're creating that world which the reader or listener or the audience then inhabits with their imagination and participates in by following the protagonist. So here though, we have something different because we're talking about diegetic prototypes, right? So we have inside mapping of a world by creating prototypes of that world, but in our world, right? So these are material prototypes which map some other worlds in order to suspend disbelief about change, in order to suspend our sense of unreality associated with that other fictional speculative world. And this is a really important point. This is where making the unreal seem real comes in, right? So this is where this transition occurs. It is at the point where we try to create an alternative model of the real in order to be able to probe it and figure it out and maybe learn something from it. Again, because we don't want to fall into inertia, crisis, collapse. And in order to create this alternative real and to do this successfully, thereby suspending this belief about it, we have to create a prototype of that world. We have to create material diegetic prototypes of that world so that they can tell us about the world. So in effect, as a practice and as a concept, design fiction is world building, right? And it's the world building in this world, right? So you're building, it could be a completely imaginary, a completely fictional, speculative reality, which is materialized by us in a controlled way in this world, in this real. Why? In order to be able to probe it and engage with it on its own terms, right? So this is where the notion of diegesis comes in. So you're mapping the interior view of a speculative world by recreating it and engaging with it as if it were real, right? So making the unreal seem real again. And this might seem quite complex on the face of it, right? So this transitions between unreal and real, between speculative and real, but pretty much everyone listening to this lecture would have encountered this many times before Particularly if you watch science fiction movies, right? Because this is what science fiction does, right? It creates this kind of interior views of speculative worlds, right? And then populates them with humans and other artifacts and aliens as well, right? And thereby creating some sort of sense of a material existence associated with these speculative worlds, right? Thereby helping us to map these interior views of alternate worlds. And a classic example here is 2001, Space Odyssey, and an excellent example of what a diegetic prototype would look like is, for example, this scene from 2001, Space Odyssey, and again, this is 1968, in which one of the protagonists is engaging with an iPad-like tablet. Again, this movie was released in 1968. And then you have a detailed description in terms of a material setting of how a human would be able to engage with this object and what this object might do, etc., etc. So you can see another in this still from the movie again. Two of the protagonists engaging with their 1968 iPads. So what is interesting here is that when Stanley Kubrick, the director of 2001 Space Odyssey, was preparing the film, so he spent an inordinate amount of time working with designers and engineers to try and create that diegetic environment, right? To create these diegetic prototypes of a speculative world. So you would have great detail surrounding each of these material artifacts. Right? So from the way humans in that specific, because all of this, what you see on the screen happens in a space station. So the way these people would be dressing, what kind of clothes would they wear? Why would they wear this kind of clothes? What would be the affordances of that? What would be the difference between now and then? How would they eat? From what appliances? With what cutlery? The iPad-like appliances with which they would engage in order to communicate and consume content. So the key thing here is that you have the creation of a world which is speculative. It does not exist in the present. It did not exist in the present of 1968 United States, but it was a fictional world that was populated with diegetic prototypes, which the actors were able to engage with, right? So this is a really good example because you have, apart from the obvious futuristic prediction here of the appearance of this kind of artifacts, you have also the visualization of a potential set of relationships between these artifacts and their human owners, right? So what would the condition of use of this artifact be? Right, this is the question that could be posed by exploring the materiality of this fictional world. And this is where the value of design fiction starts becoming visible, right? Because each of these artifacts is able to tell a story of how it might be used, of its affordances, of the kind of problems that might be involved in its use, the kind of issues that we will have to consider, the kind of cultures that it might end up generating around the track, right? So, in effect, we have the creation of completely new sets of things which in turn tell stories about that artificial world, but also about our world, right? Because we create these things, these diegetic prototypes, in this world, right? We materialize them in this world so we can trace connections between them. And the more detail we imbue this speculative world with, the more stories it starts generating for us. So, for example, you can consider this artifact, which is a speculative fictional IKEA catalog from the near future, which was created by a design fiction studio called the Near Future Laboratory. And this catalog, and I'll show you a few examples from the catalog down the track. This catalog is really fascinating because it's a specific illustration of this notion of making the unreal seem real through diegetic prototypes. And what better way to immerse ourselves in a world of diegetic prototypes than something which is always already the most materialistic instance of our world, you know, an IKEA catalog, right, which is full of these kind of objects which are already pre-positioned in their use cases, in their in a house with a specific set of affordances immediately visible. So what's happening here is that you have the trivialization of this fictional world through an IKEA catalog. So what we're having here, what we're seeing immediately, is that, you know, the catalog has holograms, and you know, you can engage with it directly in this way. And what this achieves is it's a way of provoking a new and creative look at the real which we inhabit right now. And it also allows us, as Julian Blicker, who is one of the authors of this IKEA catalog and one of the founders of the Near Future Laboratory and one of the really important thinkers when it comes to design fiction. So the way he frames it is it's about creative provocation and allows us to raise questions, to innovate and to explore the real, right? Why? Because it puts things out of whack, right? To use Franklin Spinney's terms. Creates bridges outside of our current model of reality, creates bridges with alternate speculative fictional realities, right? This is what's really valuable here. So here are two examples from the catalog. The first one is a kitchen module, which allows you to self-subscribe for food storage and pantry. So this is 99 Swedish krona per month, I imagine, per family member. So again, declutter your home by placing all fresh, perishable, frozen and diffusion foodstuffs in a central safe, encrypted, biometrically secured storage unit. Or you have the kitchen activity preparation counter, which has its own AI, active clever agent, which provides precise, friendly, sensible instructions for measurements, volumes, directions, and lively anecdotes, helping you prepare a wide range of recipes from around the world. Right. So, and it has powerful privacy controls. So, what's interesting here is you have, obviously, these appliances, these devices do not exist yet, but here we have the integration of potential future worlds in which these appliances are perfectly normal. In fact, they're trivial, right? They're part of one's kitchen and appear in an IKEA catalog. So the technology has been trivialized to this extent that it's already part and parcel of a furniture catalog. This allows us to think about these technologies, in this case, is AI assistants and the subscription-based model for food, for example. It allows us to explore these technologies in a new way, to try and see how their implementation into the everyday, into the trivial aspects, if you will, the trivial routines of the everyday, would affect us, and how it would affect the lived environment, how it would affect the technologies themselves. So notice how different this is if we an alternative approach, which would be something along the lines of just trying to describe, write a story about the way we will be using AI and these other technologies into the future, or trying to describe simple use case scenarios in text. Here you have visualization, and potentially any of these examples could be recreated in practice with diegetic prototypes in order to try and understand the interactions that will be involved when it comes to the use of these technologies in this context, in this setting, right? So you have a crossing of boundaries, right? You have putting things out of whack, in a sense, in order to understand better. So Blicker explains this again very interestingly when he says that this is a way of exploring different approaches to making things and to a way of probing the material conclusions of your imagination, right? So you are imagining the world, imagining the way this world might exist, and you're probing the materiality of this speculative imaginary environment that you've just considered, right? So this allows for the identifications of all sorts of different issues. It allows for simple exploration, but also for you could say future prototyping of potential problems that might be appearing down the track when it comes to the materialization of this speculative world. Here is another example. I like very much this idea of the moss carpet, which is a semi-organic moss-like carpet that grows slowly over your existing flooring while also producing environmental cleansing and scrubbing characteristics, right? So why not, right? So this again, or you have here a lifetime subscription for eco-friendly self-replenishing from bio-generating base starter compounds, shampoo and conditioner, right? Only $10 a month, or 10 kroner or euro, whatever, a month. So again, you have the insertion of potentially very complex technologies into a trivial daily material setting in order to see how and explore how they can be engaged with in these material terms. And I keep emphasizing the materiality of these prototypes, the materiality of these design fiction environments, because it's really important to operate at this level, at the level of material engagement with a prototype, because ideally also a prototype which is part of a routine everyday setting. So it, again, Blicker describes it very nicely, making the unreal seem real, even routine and plain. The value of the routine and plain is that it it's allows us to very easily jump between this suspension of disbelief when it comes to change, which Bruce Sterling pointed out earlier in the lecture, right? So you have a suspension of disbelief when it comes to change, when it comes to the jump from one paradigm to another, from one model of reality to another, through the creation of this routine and plain fictional worlds, right? Because again, these are designed fictional settings, designed fictional worlds, which are populated by diegetic prototypes, giving us the opportunity to engage with an alternative material, with an alternative real. And here is another illustration, again, from the catalog, design fiction IKEA catalog from the near future. Here you have a custom designed bookshelf which can be combined with a subscription lifestyle where, you know, for a certain amount a month you have Google trending items, news, book excerpts, movies, restaurant reservations delivered to your bookshelf. So the bookshelf will make sure that you're always up to date and have items that reflect your lifestyle, interests, habits, ambitions, and future self. Analog and material items will be delivered by IKEA's trusted service personnel. So in a this scenario that is described by this very plain and banal IKEA spread could be the scenario of a science fiction movie, right, which will always already have some sort of disbelief associated with it, because we immediately recognize this as something that is not real, something that is not part of our existing paradigm, our existing model of reality. Whereas here you have, through the use of the I care as the carrier, as the thoroughly familiar and domesticated frame, if you will, you have the insertion of these speculative realities, these speculative objects. So these are really good examples of the technique of creating design fiction environments. And as Blicker frames it, these prototypes, these environments, their role are to shape and form and weight an imagined idea, right? So you have an imagined world, you have a completely speculative fictional environment, and you are creating a prototype, a material instance of that idea, of that speculative environment, and thereby you're making it real. And this is a kind of prototyping that couples the speculation inherent in design with the creative license of fiction and the pragmatic imminent reality of fact. Tangible, materialized props that live in between fact and fiction and are both speculative and possible. They are not specifications for making, but they are specifications for imagining. So again, this is really, really powerful, because what Blicker indicates here, that these are not these prototypes, right? These diegetic instances of something which is speculative and fictional, their role is not to describe how this thing can be made. Their role is to allow us to imagine how one could live in this world in which this thing exists, right? So these are mappings, if you will, of an alternate real. And again, I keep focusing on this difference and the minute and details of understanding this difference, because when you step back and try and understand the value of design fiction in this context, you should be able to realize by now that its great promise and value as a practice is exactly in this ability to try and map a potential future real in terms of its internal affordances, right? You're looking to it allows you to position yourself in that potential future real only by using even one diegetic prototype which illustrates that world. And here is, as an example, another design fiction object, another diegetic prototype, which was created by researchers from Lancaster University as part of a project around using design fiction to understand the Internet of Things, right? So the Internet of Things is the next stage of the development of the Internet, where connectivity extends to all sorts of objects that we would normally not associate with connectivity at all, right? So this extends from toasters to ovens, to fridges, to shoes, toothbrushes, kettles, and everything else you can think of, right? So what would that mean to live in that world, right? So it's really helpful to answer this question if you are able to create diegetic prototypes which illustrate the material affordances of that world. And through engaging with these design fiction objects, with these diegetic prototypes of a speculative world, one is able not only to start developing an idea of how living and engaging in that speculative world would look like, but also one is able to see and look at our existing world in a new and interesting way. So here we have an example from Peter Colton and team's work on design fiction and the Internet of Things. And this is the kettle, which is called Polly, the world's first truly smart kettle. So in the process of developing this prototype, they created a complete marketing campaign for this speculative non-existing object. This is a kettle connected to the internet, and which does a bunch of things. So they illustrated this, they made it as real as possible, right? So they created prototypes for all sorts of different scenarios. So in the process, they argued that the first question that this artifact, this prototype answers is not the what if question, which is what would happen if we did this. Instead, the primary purpose is to invite you into the world to begin to build up layers of texture, right? So by engaging in this world, you're starting to build texture, starting to populate this world with even more layers and meaning, right? So it becomes even more real, right? So again, the world started with you developing only a simple diegetic prototype, but by exploring the prototype, you start asking questions and answering them about other aspects of that world. And in turn, these other aspects of that world start informing the prototype, right? So you have this kind of feedback loop developing. And these are examples again of that campaign that they developed, which is, you know, different artifacts which are associated with that a poly kettle. So you have the tea and the outside, you know, billboards and messaging, etc., etc. And again, even more examples of these mappings of that speculative reel. So we have the ability to download custom boil profiles from the cloud, the linking, the pairing of this object to, for example, the car, where, you know, you have a specific, the object is indicating how much water you need in order to defrost the front window of the car, presumably. So again, this is for cold climates. You know, the ability to connect to your socials, so to tell you that, you know, someone is near, do you want to invite that someone for a brew? And again, the ability to indicate what the weather is and that the windscreen visibility is low. So in effect, you have again the mapping of that world, the expansion of that world through the further engagement with the diegetic prototype. So in effect, you can start seeing what the payoff is by of creating this one prototype, because in effect you start understanding much more about the world in which this kind of objects would be able to exist. You start seeing the potential here. You start understanding how that system would operate. That system in which this object would make sense and would be a routine and plain. So in effect, we have an emergent quality which is associated with the practice of design fiction, which becomes visible when you consider the fact that when you create that artifact, right, you start trying to imagine its material setting in which that artifact would be operating, right? Even though the artifact itself is already materially realized, that you've made it as a diegetic prototype of that speculative world. But in effect, you have to start imagining how it will operate in its setting, in that world, right? And so you have to start making the linkages between that world and the artifact. And in effect, you are creating even more texture. So if you start creating other artifacts which are part and parcel of that world, you are creating, as Colton and company describe this in this excellent graph, you're creating additional entry points into the world. And each entry point describes the world is at a different scale. So you have this kind of reciprocal prototyping relationship where the world is prototyping the artifacts and the artifacts are prototyping the world, right? It's a closed loop in which you're expanding that speculative reel. And the payoff here is the ability to see these relationships, to understand them from the perspective of our existing paradigm, our existing model, and to potentially see completely new ways of doing things, completely new approaches, completely new ways of thinking and seeing the real. So this was quite a lot. Let's try and summarize what we've discovered so far. So design fiction is a practice, a way of imagining speculative realities, new paradigms. It could be used as a way of imagining new technologies, new objects, or even new contexts, new situations, right? So all that it requires is that whatever it is that we are imagining is non-existent, right? It's speculative, it's fictional, right? It's outside of our existing model, outside of our existing known paradigm of the real. And the practice itself uses tangible prototyping, right? These diegetic material prototypes to visualize and experience the procedures of that fictional alternate or future real, right? So the key thing here is that we're trying to visualize these procedures of how that real will operate. And in the process, because this is a material artifact we've generated, it allows us to experience these procedures. Right? It opens our mind, our thinking, to a completely new way of doing something, whatever that is, whatever it is that we are prototyping. And this allows us to ask how things might be, how this something might be in this speculative future that we are trying to describe, or in this alternate present. And it allows us to examine why things might be that way and highlight potential problems and opportunities. So we have the practice of design fiction gives us the option to ask how something might be in an alternate or speculative or fictional reality, or in a future reality that is speculative for the moment, and examine how it will operate, its procedures of existence, and why would it be operating in that way. Right, so notice this mapping of an alternate real gives us so many potential interesting questions and so many potential interesting answers, which we would otherwise have no way of asking and no way of receiving, right, in terms of answers. So these diegetic prototypes that we've generated through the practice of design fiction, they help us think and look at the real in a new way. And if you recall how we started this short lecture, this was exactly the goal, right? The goal is to be able to look at the real, at that ever-changing and complicated world we're inhabiting in a new way, in order to be able to operate in it and understand it better, right? So, and this is where speculative prototypes are so helpful. So this practice of speculative modeling of the real, just to summarize it yet again, allows us, by building a model of how something fictional might operate, to experience it and play with it as if it were real, and in the process to understand that real, as well as understand the real we inhabit now in a new way, right? To look at it in a new way. And this is what creating situations where things go out of whack in an interesting way is all about. This is how we could answer this question we asked in the beginning: how can we make things go out of whack in an interesting way so that we can learn something by seeing something new and strange? Alright, that's it from me. If you have any questions, please hit me up on Twitter at TedMeetYou. Thank you all for listening. And see you online.